All right, what is going on, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to the one and only Wrestling Otaku channel where the best reviews wrestling. And I'm back here. It is now officially Sunday night, April the 14th of 2024. So here tonight, I'm here to give you another edition of my official weekly AEW Rampage review. All right, man, so let's get into the show here. So this week's AEW Rampage review will be for the show that took place on April the 12th, Friday, April the 12th of 2024. We are 2 days removed from the show taking place. So I'm doing a little bit of catching up here. Of course, Collision and Battle of the Belts was last night. I'll do the Rampage review first, which I'm doing here, and then I'll do my Collision and Battle of the Belts review simultaneously, probably, if not later tonight, at some point tomorrow. So the Rampage for this week was about as average a show as you could. It was decent enough. It was pretty much a standard Rampage show. Had a couple matches, some pretty quick ones, and some of them, two in specific, were fairly decent length in terms of, you know, timing. But all in all, it was a pretty average episode of Rampage. Nothing too spectacular about it. It wasn't terrible, but it was just a pretty standard episode of Rampage here. So let's just get into it here. Let me just get into the review here. I'm going to run through everything that happened on the show briefly, matches, segments, everything in between. Going to give you guys my overall review and my grade at the end of the video, as I always do. So if that being said, without further ado, let's get right into the show here. Show kicks off with our first match. It was Orange Cassidy one-on-one versus Alex Reynolds of the Dark Order. He was accompanied by John Silver, who was at ringside. And before the match, you know, as the match was about to start, the commentators, you know, made mention of course, the whole situation from last, you know, of course, on, was it Dynamite? No, Collision from last week, where Trent Beretta ended up turning on Orange Cassidy as a result of, you know, them losing in the AEW Tag Title Tournament. You know, they lost to the Young Bucks, and Trent Beretta turned on Orange Cassidy. They showed that footage beforehand, and so we would get, quote, Orange Cassidy's thoughts on the whole Trent Beretta situation. But first, this match. Match was decent enough. You know, they went back and forth. Again, standard Rampage match. Nothing too spectacular about it. It was fine for what it was, though. Back and forth for the most part. You saw John Silver try to get involved on... he got involved on numerous occasions. He pulled, you know, distracted Orange Cassidy, allowing Alex Reynolds to take advantage. At some certain parts of the match, he did physically get involved. He took shots at Orange Cassidy, including, like, a suplex on the outside, which eventually Orange Cassidy did get, you know, payback on John Silver on the outside due to his constant interference. At one point, he had a suicide dive. He beat up, you know, took the fight to Alex Reynolds. And this was about, I want to say, around a 10-minute match, give or take. You know, it wasn't too long. It was about a 10-minute, or a little over 10 minutes, maybe, possibly, you know, with a commercial break in between. So eventually, the match ends with Orange Cassidy took out Alex Reynolds and John Silver with a dive. He tosses Alex Reynolds back into the ring. He hits a orange punch on John Silver for good measure, taking him out after, you know, throwing him into the barricade. Gets back in the ring, hits a big orange punch after throwing his elbow pad down, hits the orange punch on Alex Reynolds, and gets the pin on him for the 1-2-3 and the win. So Orange Cassidy with a solid victory, emphatic victory here over Alex Reynolds, and that's pretty much it for the match. I'll give it a C overall. Like I said, it was an okay match. Nothing great about it, nothing terrible about it. It was just a standard Rampage match. So that's pretty much it for that. C grade overall. It was fine. Orange Cassidy, obviously, the victor here. So after the match, Renee Paquette gets on the ring. She congratulates Orange Cassidy on his victory. And then she makes note of what Trent Beretta did, you know, basically turning on him and effectively severing ties with the best friends. And she goes to ask Orange Cassidy his thoughts. So Orange Cassidy proceeds to speak. He gets to, and then suddenly Trent Beretta comes out, and, you know, the crowd, of course, reacts. So the camera pans, you see Trent Beretta making his way down to ringside, or making his way down the rampway, and he's got this shirt on. You couldn't see it at first because he got a coat over it, but he kind of takes the coat off, and it says something to the effect of best friends failed to get the job done against the Young Bucks, or something like that. I couldn't read the whole thing because the camera panned too quick. So Trent Beretta makes his way down to the ringside. He takes his jacket off. It looks like we're about to see a confrontation between Orange Cassidy and Beretta. So then suddenly, out of nowhere, Chuck Taylor appears in the ring from behind Orange Cassidy. He doesn't notice him at first. But then as Trent Beretta goes to the rampway, or, you know, he gets up on the apron, Chuck Taylor walks around Orange Cassidy. He was behind him. He walks around Orange Cassidy, goes to where Trent Beretta is. Trent Beretta drops down, backs away. And at this point, the commentators were making mention of, they didn't know where Chuck Taylor, what his allegiance is in this whole thing, because he hasn't really said anything. So Chuck Taylor eyes down Trent Beretta. Trent Beretta goes back up the rampway. And then Chuck Taylor turns around, doesn't even really say anything to Orange Cassidy. He just kind of shoots him a look. And then he goes back, you know, outside the ring on the other side and goes through the crowd. And Orange Cassidy is standing in the ring there, dumbfounded. And so So that's pretty much it for that. So we still, to this point, don't really know what Chuck Taylor's, where Chuck Taylor's allegiance is in this whole thing. We don't know, why Trent Beretta ended up ultimately turning on Orange Cassidy. I'm sure we'll get, at some point in the future, an explanation, maybe on next week's Rampage or Collision. Which, by the way, it was announced on Collision that next week, Rampage and Collision will be, you know, they'll be showing both of them together on Saturday. You know, it'll be a double Rampage Collision Super Show, much like this week was with Collision and Battle of the Belts. So, I imagine we're going to see, hopefully, an explanation from Trent Beretta and maybe some words from Chuck Taylor and even Orange Cassidy, because nothing was really said here outside of, you know, Chuck Taylor basically chasing away Trent Beretta. So, but we'll see what happens. That's pretty much it for that. All right, moving on here. As soon as the laptop freaking, I had it freaking on the screen. I just wanted to make sure that I got everything here. The laptop's acting slow. Okay, moving on. So next up, we get a backstage interview with Alex Marvez. Well, Alex Marvez interviews Anna Jay, and he basically asks her, you know, why she attacked Mariah May after the match. And Anna Jay basically said she was frustrated, she was mad as to how that match ended, and she basically is sick and tired of seeing, you know, Mariah May and you know, Mina Shirakawa going around and kissing each other and, you know, drinking champagne. And she mentions Toni Storm as well, and she's tired of seeing, you know, them, quote, acting all, you know, chummy and acting, you know, like there's no, you know, they don't have a care in the world, so on and so forth. And she basically says, you know, she's done with it, it's time for people to get serious or whatever. So then in walks Stardom talent Izumi, you know, spelled AZM, you know, it's pronounced Izumi. So Izumi walks in and, you know, interrupts kind of the interview from Anna Jay here, and she basically says that Mariah May is stupid, Mina Shirakawa is stupid, and specifically Toni Storm is stupid. But come tomorrow on Collision, I'm going to face Toni Storm one-on-one, and I'm going to show her, I'm going to show her basically just who I am, or something like that. So then she and the Anna Jay fist bump, and that's pretty much it for that. So yeah, Izumi, it was also mentioned later that Izumi will be taking on Timeless Toni Storm, you know, non-title match, you know, for on Collision, which that match ended up happening on Collision. Which, by the way, is my first time seeing Izumi. Like, I know she's wrestled before. I believe she was in, you know, a couple New Japan matches. I think she wrestled Mercedes Moné, where Mercedes Moné was the New Japan, you know, IWGP Women's Champion. And apparently she's a part of Stardom as well, along with Mina Shirakawa and Mariah May. And she apparently made an appearance or two at Ring of Honor as well. And also a CMLL, if I'm not mistaken. But yeah, so little backstage interview here with Anna Jay, and then Izumi kind of, you know, comes in. And so yeah, there's obviously some camaraderie a little bit between Anna Jay and Izumi. Anyway, that's pretty much it for that. Moving on. So next up, after a commercial break, we get our second match of the show here. This one being a open house rules match, house rules match for the TBS title. Julia Hart defends against Layla Hirsch. You know, first time we've seen Layla Hirsch on the AEW program in like over a year. So it's been a good while. She's apparently been wrestling in Ring of Honor primarily, or on Ring of Honor TV primarily, but this is her first AEW appearance in well over a year. But anyway, so both ladies get in the ring, the match begins. It was a solid match. It wasn't too long, actually. I think it ended, like, prematurely, but I'll get to that. But back and forth for the most part. Layla Hirsch took the fight to Julia Hart in the beginning. Julia worked her over, you know, about a minute or so in. Julia worked her over, hit her for a couple hard, stiff shots, beats her up in the corner, tosses her around for a bit. Then eventually Layla Hirsch gets back into it. She, you know, utilizes her unique offense, had a nice snap German, had a couple nice suplex variations as well. So this match ended up being about 4 or 5 minutes. Like I said, it ended prematurely because there was a spot on the outside where Layla Hirsch was going on the offense on Julia Hart, and she tossed Julia Hart out of the ring. Layla Hirsch ran against the ropes, did a dive, suicide dive through the ropes. She tried it earlier in the match, but Julia Hart cut her off with an elbow. This time, she hits the dive, and she connects with Julia Hart, and I don't know if, like, they collided or, you know, something. I don't know if she mistimed it or she collided or landed wrong, but Layla Hirsch hits Julia Hart with this move, and then she instantly starts selling like she hurt herself. And then Julia, you know, you notice Julia Hart's in the ring. She's really, like, you know, she's selling her shoulder. And I don't know if she got, like, a legit hurt. I don't know if she injured herself. But anyway, so there was, like, a couple seconds, like a pause almost. Layla grabs Julia, tosses her back into the ring, and then she, again, like, kind of, kind of does, like, you know, she, almost like she's wincing in pain or whatever. She's slow to get back in the ring. Julia Hart's in the corner. She's also wincing in pain. And the referee's, like, checking on her. And Layla Hirsch gets in the ring. Like I said, there's like a 4 or 5 second pause. Then Layla goes after Julia. Julia takes her foot, pushes Layla Hirsch off. Then she gets up, grabs her, pulls her down, gets her like a cradle pin. And then just like that, gets the 1-2-3 and the win. So kind of an anticlimactic finish. Again, I'm not sure if they forced the finish here because one of the two or both of them got injured on that dive. But yeah, so that was it for the match. It was a promising match. Like, it was a decent, you know, outing from both ladies. I personally would have liked to see more, but I don't know. Again, I think they got hurt on the suicide dive attempt. You know, either Julia got hurt or, you know, both of them got hurt because they were both, like, selling like they were hurt. So, you know, Julia afterwards was, you know, wincing, you know, feeling at her shoulder, you know, grabbing her arm or shoulder or whatever. And Layla Hirsch was, you know, kind of motioning towards her head like she hurt herself. But again, I'm not sure what I hope. Both of them are okay, especially Julia. Julia Hart's, you know, TBS champion. She's set to defend the title at the next pay-per-view. So, but I don't know what happened there. I hope they're both okay. But anyway, so that's pretty much it for the match. I won't necessarily give this a grade because it was so short. If I had to, I'd give it a C overall. Again, I would have, if the match had played out all the way, which I'm sure they were planning to give Julia Hart the win anyway, but I think it would have been a decent enough. I think if they gave this some time, if they had the time, this would have been a decent little match. I'll give it a C overall, but yeah, we'll see what happens with that going forward. But anyway, that's pretty much it for that. Moving on. So next up, we get a video package hyping up our next match with Angelo Parker and you know, Saraya's brother Zach Knight, and they show the video package with that. So then we get our third match of the show here. Angelo Parker, a cool hand. Angelo Parker, one-on-one versus Zach Knight. So both guys make their entrance. The match begins. They start fighting on the rampway immediately, like, you know, as Zach Knight was making his entrance. Angelo Parker dove out and, you know, attacked Zach Knight before he even got in the ring. Saraya and Harley Cameron, who accompany Zach Knight, you know, basically cause a distraction, allowing Zach Knight to take advantage. He tosses Angelo Parker around on the outside for a bit. Tosses him into the barricade, tosses him into the ring post, and at this point, Zach Knight took total control of the match, and that was pretty much. And then eventually, they both got in the ring. The referee asked, you know, Angelo Parker, after he got beat on for like a good minute or so outside the ring, they both got back into the ring eventually. Angelo Parker was asked if he wants to, you know, have the match, and he says, "Ring the bell, ring the bell." So the bell rings, the match officially begins. Very, you know, physical match here. Well, it was pretty much, this match was all, outside of like a handful of, you know, spots near the end, this match was all Zach Knight. You know, Angelo Parker had hardly any offense in this match, mostly because of, again, the post-match attack or pre-match attack, you know. Well, Angelo Parker wanted to attack Zach Knight, but it backfired. But anyway, so Zach Knight dominates him. You know, this was really, I think, Zach Knight's first, you know, match or his debut match, at least in terms of AEW. I'm not sure if he wrestled in Ring of Honor or wrestled anywhere else before, but in terms of his debut match, I thought he looked pretty solid. Obviously, more so of a physical, like, he's kind of like a physical, imposing style wrestler. He seems like more of a striker, and he also utilizes power moves, but he seems like more of a striker. Very similar to, if I could make a comparison, he's very similar to Karrion Kross, you know, with his offense, with the way he kind of executes his offense. Like, he delivers the strikes in almost like kind of like a menacing, like a calculating way. That's kind of like how Zach Knight was here in this match. But anyway, so he works over Angelo Parker for the majority of it. Match itself was a little over 10 minutes, or it was around 10 minutes, with commercial break in between. Eventually, Angelo Parker does get some shots in. At you know, one point, Angelo Parker was busted open early in the match, and he continued fighting. He continued, you know, trading strikes with Zach Knight, hits him with a couple, you know, quick moves. At one point, he had a suplex coming off the turnbuckle. He had a couple nice neck breakers, you know, one or two, you know, moves in between. And eventually, Zach Knight cut him off, hits him with a hard clothesline, two exchange strikes again. Zach Knight hits him with a clothesline, hits him with like a big back elbow or some kind of, you know, striking move, gets a couple close near falls, and then finally the match finishes with Zach Knight basically standing over Angelo Parker, like menacingly just, you know, mocking him or whatever. And then finally, Angelo Parker, like, says, you know, I think he pie-faced him or says something to Zach Knight. Zach Knight comes off the ropes, hits him with like a big running fist or like a big running fist or running strike or whatever move he used. And then he finally got the pin on Angelo Parker. He was out at that point and he got the 1-2-3. And that's pretty much it for that. So Zach Knight gets a pinfall victory here over over Angela Parker. At one point, also, I forgot to mention Saraya and Harley Cameron, who were trying to cause a distraction, were ejected from ringside. Not that it mattered, because Zack Knight still won. But anyway, that's pretty much it for the match. So, Zack Knight in his debut match here on Rampage, and his debut in AEW, in terms of in-ring debut, got the victory here over Angela Parker. And that's pretty much it for that. So I'll give this match a C+ overall. I thought Zack Knight looked very, for his first match, this is my first time ever seeing him wrestle, he looked pretty damn imposing, I'll say that. So he's definitely somebody who is worth, you know, taking a look at. You know, I think he's got potential to be something very interesting, like in terms of an in-ring, like an imposing in-ring figure, in terms of, you know, I like to see more of what he does from a wrestling standpoint. But, you know, but from this first match, He showed some promise, so I'll say that. But anyway, so after the match, Zack Knight, Saraya, and Harley Cameron stood over Angela Parker's prone body on the mat, and, you know, and Zack Knight was just, he got right into Angela's face. He was rubbing his, you know, forehead, because he had blood on his forehead, and he wiped the blood from Angela Parker's forehead on his freaking chest. Kind of like some Brock Lesnar shit, if you remember what Lesnar did that shit, like, in 2003. But anyway, so, and then afterwards they leave, and, you know, Angela Parker's, you know, basically left for dead, more or less. And so that's pretty much it for that, man. So I guess we'll have to wait and see how this, you know, how they follow up from this, because Angela Parker's, he's taking the loss here to Zack Knight, and the whole, you know, this whole thing started with, obviously, the romance angle between Angela Parker and Ruby Soho, which... It was, I think it was like a week or so ago, where Ruby Soho basically said that Angelo Parker's on his own, you know. If he is going to fight Zack Knight here, he's basically on his own or whatever. And so we'll see how they follow this up, you know. We'll see if this whole Angelo Parker-Ruby Soho thing is still ongoing, or if this is it. We'll see. But that's pretty much it for that. All right, moving on. All right, so next up, after all of that, we get another commercial. Then we get a backstage interview segment. Alex Marvez interviews he interviews Rocky Romero at first. And Rocky Romero basically talks about facing Roderick Strong in a international title eliminator match on tomorrow night's edition of Battle of the Belts. And now, you know, that match was hyped up, whatever. So he's basically talking about that. Then Kyle O'Reilly comes in, and Kyle O'Reilly basically says, you know, Rocky Romero, he basically... you know, gives him props, gives him praise for, you know, what he's done in the past, and he praises him as a past opponent. He says, you know, when we fought each other, you brought out the best in me, and I hope at some point, you know, he basically wishes him well in his eliminator match against Roderick Strong, and he says, you know, if it ever came to it, if you ever became international champion, I'd like a shot at the title, and so on and so forth. And then Rocky said, you know, he agrees to it, and they shake hands, they show respect. So then Rocky Romero goes to leave, and Kyle O'Reilly, you know, he is about to leave, and then suddenly he hears, Kyle! And the freaking Roderick Strong comes in with the Undisputed Kingdom, and Roderick Strong basically says to Kyle O'Reilly, he says, well, what was that? You know, what did I just see here? Blah, blah, blah. And Kyle O'Reilly basically says, oh, you know, I was just showing respect, so on and so forth, you know. And Roderick Strong basically takes offense to the fact that he said he would face Rocky Romero if he became champion, but, you know, and he takes offense to it. He's basically insinuating that Rocky Romero is going to beat him. And Kyle basically says, no, man, I was just paying respect. And, you know, in terms of, you know, competing for a title, I wouldn't want to, you know, compete against you, so on and so forth, because, you know, and he basically pays, you know, Roderick Strong respect as well. And Roddy says, listen, you know, I respect the fact that you want to do it on your own, and I want to see you become a champion at some point, just as long as it has nothing to do with me. And then he walks off, and so that's pretty much it for that. So clearly they were teasing. It was a little tease right there. There was a little tease of a little bit of friction, if you will, between Roderick Strong and Kyle O'Reilly. That's very important, you know, considering what happened on the following night. I'll get to that when I do the review for that. But that's pretty much it for that. All right, so then next up we get our main event match, our final match of the show here, fourth match of the show. It might as well be the main event, the final match of the show here. Jay White 1-on-1 versus Matt Sydal. Another fine match here. Both guys go back and forth. You know, Jay White worked over Matt Sydal for a good portion of this match. Then Matt Sydal came back. You know, it's kind of a back and forth at first. Then Jay White took the advantage. He took the initiative, worked over Jay White for a bit. Really solid moves out of Jay White. He really kept pace with Matt Sydal here. Matt Sydal got his shots in as well. You saw some nice high-risk maneuvers, you know, a couple springboard, you know, a couple dives, whatever have you. So Matt Sydal was on point here as well. So I thought this was a solid match from these two. It went, you know, the remainder of the TV time, which was about a little over 12, 13-minute match, give or take. I thought it was a solid outing for both guys. Good showcase match for, you know, Jay White, also for Matt Sydal in a way. So eventually the match ends when Matt Sydal is getting the offense in on Jay White. He hits a couple of, you know, one or two, you know, cross, but dive moves, whatever have you, coming off the ropes, couple of close near falls. So then he goes to, after he hits a Poison Rana, after he, you know, counters Jay White's attempt at a Blade Runner, he hits the Poison Rana, reverse Hurricanrana. So then he goes up to the top, goes for a Meteora off the top turnbuckle. Jay White sidesteps it, catches him, gets him in a, sidesteps him, grabs his head, hits him with the Blade Runner, and then, you know, gets the pin on him for the 1-2-3 and the win. So Jay White gets the victory here. Like I said, Matt Sydal, you know, Matt Sydal took, you know, Jay White to task here for the most part, especially in the second part of the, or the back end of the match after the picture-in-picture commercial break. But Jay White pulls it out here. Jay White gets the victory over Matt Sydal, and that's it for the match. So I'll give this one a C-plus overall. I thought it was really good. You know, I thought it was a solid match. Again, good showcase match for Matt Sydal and for Jay White for the most part. But anyway, so that's pretty much it for that. Jay White gets the victory, and afterwards you see the guns get in the ring and they all celebrate, and that's pretty much how Rampage went off the air. There wasn't any real shenanigans afterwards, you know, and not with the Acclaimed or not with, you know, Bullet Club Gold attacking their opponent or whatever. It was just Jay White and the guns celebrating in the ring. They have their arms raised, and that's how the show went off the air. So that's pretty much it for that. So that was it for Rampage. So like I said, it's only an hour long, so they don't have a whole lot of stuff. Usually they'll have a whole lot of matches on Rampage. So on this show there are four matches. Of them, I personally thought the main event was the best one quality wise. Jay White and Matt Sydal I thought looked really good. Outside of that, the opening match, the opening match with Alex Reynolds and Orange Cassidy was decent. Zack Knight and Angela Parker was certainly something. You know, it was. Zack Knight looked pretty solid in his debut match here on AEW. And then the TBS title match, I think, was promising until, I think, you know, again, one of them got hurt. So all in all, I thought this was a solid episode of Rampage, and we'll see what happens in the future. And then, of course, the following night, they had Collision and Battle of the Belts, which I'll do my review for that separate at some point, if not later tonight, tomorrow. But yeah, so that was it for Rampage. So for my money, I thought it was an okay episode. Standard Rampage. I enjoyed the matches that I saw. It was fine for what it was. I mean, it's Rampage, so it's not going to be anything that blows you away, you know, but I thought it was an okay show. Anyway, that was pretty much it for that. That was everything that happened on the show, and that's going to conclude this review. So let me just wrap this up real quick here. Those are my thoughts on the show as a whole. My overall review, good show. I'll give it a thumbs up. I enjoyed the matches that they had on here. And my overall grade on a scale of 1 to 10, I'll go ahead and give this week's Rampage a 6.5. 6.5 out of 10. So there you have it. Those are my thoughts, my overall review, my grade is 6.5 out of 10. So yeah, that's pretty much going to do it for that. So that will conclude my AEW Rampage review for this week. So thank you guys for watching. And once again, I want to thank everybody who's been subbing to the channel. Any of you, anybody new to the channel, I've been getting a surge in subscribers within the last couple days now, ever since I uploaded that video on Wednesday in regards to the whole CM Punk, Jack Perry situation. Ever since that, I've been getting a shit ton of views and quite a good number of subscribers. I've been getting a lot of traffic here on the channel in the last couple days, you know, in the last 4 or 5 days, and it's been really encouraging. We're currently at, what, 320 subs at this point, and it's still climbing. The sub count is still going up, so very encouraging, and I hope that continues, man. I hope we continue this momentum. I hope we continue this trend going into the future, going into the rest of this month and the rest of this year. So I appreciate all of you. So thanks for watching this review. For those of you who have watched up to this point, and like I said before, I'll be giving you my Collision and Battle of the Belts review probably tomorrow, or I might decide to do it later tonight, depending on how I feel. It all depends. It's about 9:22 here, 9:22 p.m., so I got some time if I want to do it. But anyway, that's going to wrap up this review, so thank you again for watching this Rampage review. If you enjoyed this video, be sure to leave a like, hit the like button, leave a comment, give me your thoughts on this week's AEW Rampage episode if you watched it. Give your thoughts on my review of it. Subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. Once again, please appreciate all the support you can get. With that being said, that's pretty much going to do it, man. So once again, thank you for watching this week's edition of my AEW Rampage review here on the Wrestling Otaku channel, where the best reviews wrestling. And that's going to do it for me. So thank you for watching once more. Until next time, this has been the Rest of Otaku. And I'll see you guys later in the next video. Till then, I'm out. Have a good rest of your night. And I'll see you in the next video. Till then, peace. Hello, folks. I thank you all for watching this video. Certainly hope you enjoyed the content. I salute you. So if you did enjoy it, be sure to check out all of my other videos on the channel. And as always, be sure to subscribe to the Wrestling Otaku channel for more excellent content, courtesy of the best in the IWC and YWC. Have a good one, ladies and gentlemen.